basically. I go for refuge until I'm enlightened to the Buddha, the Dharma, the Sangha. On the accumulation of the practice of giving and so forth, may I become a Buddha to benefit all sentient beings. I go for refuge until I'm enlightened to the Buddha, the Dharma, the Sangha. On the accumulation of the practice of giving and so forth, may I become a Buddha to benefit all sentient beings. I go for refuge until I'm enlightened to the Buddha, the Dharma, the Sangha. On the accumulation of the practice of giving and so forth, page, turn to page 214. We read the sentences together and see how much you can see which, how much we can invoke the respective experiences, say when mentioning the benefits of general wisdom of emptiness, when the wisdom of emptiness actually flash out, when the experiences of the wisdom of emptiness is being shared with us, if what to see how much can improve respective experiences. Given by the Arya Sabhurish Sutra, Precious Child Sutra, Manjushri, who listens in the doubt to this teaching, volunteers generates much greater merit than Bodhisattva, who like skilled beings practices the six professions for 100,000 eons. It is being so, when he is there to say anything about a person who listens to his teaching without a doubt. But maybe he can say anything about a person who has the scripture in writing, memorizes it, and also teaches it formally and extensively to others. Arya Tathagata Gagpa Nama Sutra, the threshold of God, is called Sutra. Any person who possesses all the understanding of the world enters into the teaching of the selflessness and is faith in the conviction that all phenomena from the beginning of your true existence does not go to a bad end. If any issue, the Amar says that all phenomena are absolutely classified of inherent existence and the beginning of defilements is the word of self-nature, then removes the guilt of having defilements and the unstable defilements, thus leaving even the immeasurable mental that is dysfunctional, that are known as secondary laws that are associated with ethics and issues. Aridivas, Chitris, the Tathagata Shastra, Mahama Karika, 400 verses. Those who are less married will not be in any doubt. Acharya Chandragati is Mathya Bhagavatam entering the middle way.
Even as a holy being, when hearing about emptiness, the one experiences with an utter joy again and again, tears flowing from such pure joy, most of one's eyes, and one's hair stands on the hand, one's the seed of the wisdom of full awakening.
Upari Upari Prachana Nama Mahana Sutra, Upari Rikasa Sutra. The various delightful spots bottom and the sparkling Supreme Government balls standing up. For none of these is their creator, they are possible by the power of God. It is through conceptualization that the world is interior. Bhikkhu Majira's actions in the coming reading sutra. A mind is demonic which means the true self. There is no being in there. Just as one destiny is a car in dependence upon direction of thoughts, so there is a direction of sentient being in dependence upon obedience. An excerpt from Venerable Shavara's writings. Searching for reality throughout space, one finds from the periphery and the center. All perception sees completely. Likewise, through total search of mind phenomena, one finds from even an atom of essence. Since the search of mind is not found, not seeing anything is seen in reality. An extract from St. Salaha's writings. By entering into emptiness by devoted compassion, one will not find the supreme path. At the same time, by meditating upon compassion alone, one will not attain the liberation but remains in samsara. Whose neighbor is capable of grasping the unity of the two, will not remain in samsara nor one person in mind. Samadhi Raja Sutra, King Concentration Sutra. Just as in the dream of the young girl, she met the war and saw his death. Joyous was she at the meeting and in anguish at his death. You all are the one master. Arya Nagarjuna's Mula Madhya Karika, the fundamental wisdom in the middle way. Through seizing common afflictions, Nirvana is achieved. Common afflictions arise from disordered conceptions. These arise from the vibrations of grasping true existence. The vibration is seized by all into emptiness. Neither enemy is no different from the enemies, every is no different from them, nor is he dependent on them, but the Tathagata tells us himself that he is worse than the Tathagata. That which dependently originates is possible to them to independent existence, that being dependently designated is in the middle way. Since there is no phenomenon that is not dependently originated, therefore there is no phenomenon that is not empty. Arya Nagarjuna's Ramnama Rav Prashtana.
If the person is not earth, not water, not fire, not wind, not space, but also consciousness, not all of them, there's a personality pose. Just as a person is not a true existent, the group of being and aggregation of the six constituents, so each constituent also not true existence as they have the aggregation of their own constituents.
Arivivarjuna's Bodhicitta Vivarana and commentary on Bodhicitta.
Those who understand the essentials of all phenomena, it also performs the law of harmony and results. That is more amazing than amazing, there's more wonders than wonders.
Aridevas Chatusabhama Shastra Nama Kariga, 40 verses.
When dependent arise and see, ignorance does not occur. Thus do all others try to find the subject.
Guiding the view of the four mindfulnesses, His Holiness Kyasangyaso, the seventh Dalai Lama.
At the crossroads of the six directions of consciousness, there are diverse perceptions. I see the easy dualistic phenomenon which is faceless. There's a magical show that is by nature deceptive. Don't believe it to be true, but view it as having the nature of emptiness. Don't let a mind go astray, but place it in the nature of appearance emptiness. Do not lose mindfulness, hold it in the nature of appearance emptiness.
An extract from prayers to proliferate in the Dharma and the schools is only the 14th Dalai Lama.
Whenever the Marka Bhutala, Shaya Dorji and so on, the host of the precious are healed the blessing. A chain of the honest masters of his outstanding traditions, to you are all a prayer. May the Buddha Dharma and the schools, this forevermore, all phenomena and promises of Sahara and Nirvana are by the radiance of spontaneous awareness. Awareness itself to what elevations is realized in the nature of Dharma, pervading all existences and appearances of Nirvana is the great Mahamudra. May the Buddha Dharma and others know the day for everyone.
Dharma Dhatu Stava in praise of Dharma Dhatu.
Impermanent suffering and empty, each to be a purified mind. A Dharma that is actually passing through your mind is the level of transcendental nature.
The concluding prayer of Namasimhapa's commentary on Arivivarjuna's fundamental wisdom of the middle way.
Throughout our future lifetimes, we are always guided by our intuition and be able to uphold the Dharma in general and the teachings of the heavenly origination in particular, even in the personal life.
Okay, up with the folded hands.
Shiri Heruka, Shiri Heruka, Shiri Heruka. He is the substance of phenomena. The mind that is the source of everything is empty of existence, as it is the purity of causal nature. Ru is the substance of the person, the emptiness of the self, that is fabricated by the web of conceptual thought and grasp of the self of person. Ka is the ultimate reality, the absence of the disordered duality of such a reality. Shri is the non dual exalted wisdom that arises in congruence with emptiness or objective. This is the meaning of A.
Yesterday we were doing the method of equalizing and exchanging self-others, which are the Bodhicitta. The method of equalizing self and others, equalizing and exchanging self-others. And we already done the step one and part of step two. Step two, reflecting on the demerits of cherishing oneself. And reflecting on the demerits of cherishing oneself, we learn that there are two main points to the mind. One is how this self-centered attitude, it obscures the Buddha nature, thus making you vulnerable to all miseries. Okay. So this part we are done. In fact, to review, to make it very quick, review. We look for happiness and we shun miseries. This is the reality. Whether you're a believer, whether you're a non-believer, whether you're following science, whether you're following spirituality, or whether you're just in the gross family world, or whether you are, say, Buddhists, Hindus, Muslims, say, Jews, and whatever, whoever you are, we all want happiness, we don't want suffering. This is reality. This is reality. On this basis, exploring a little bit, exploring the nature of yourself a little bit, we come to know that first, We look for ways and means to make yourself happy, and we tend to just push aside what makes us not happy. This is another reality that we are with. If the ultimate, if this Buddha nature within, if that is activated, if that is activated fully, if the ultimate mental problems are gone, then we don't have to put any effort to make yourself happy, and we don't have to put any effort to shed the miseries, because you are the happiness, you are the zero misery, the Buddha nature, when awakened. So, while this is the tremendous potential that you have, tremendous treasure that you have, but when we look at how we are today, we see we are so vulnerable. We have to always look for ways and means to get happiness. We have to always run away from miseries. This is the fact. So, if you have this treasure, why don't you have it? Why do you have to run away from suffering? Why do you have to always look for happiness? Because this potential, this treasure remains dominant. This treasure remains hidden, obscure. And who obscures that? Who forbids this treasure from coming out? Self-grasping ignorance. So, therefore, this self-grasping ignorance is so vicious in not allowing you to experience happiness, in not allowing you to stop miseries in its natural form. It makes you so vulnerable. Now that you look for happiness, you don't want suffering, then we have to look for happiness. And then we have to run away from the suffering. We become so vulnerable. Run away means you're weak. We are weak. And going to crave for happiness, which means that we are poor. We don't have that happiness. We crave for that. We go for, look for that. Who made us poor? Who made us weak? Self-centered energy. Right? So, if you think more seriously on this matter, in this line, if you think more seriously, it's like, what seems to be, oh, this is idealistic. What seems to be a little idealistic at this point will slowly become so real that whenever you're confronted with some problems, sickness, aging, ailment, confrontation, and then tragedies befalling you, feeling low, feeling hollow, meaninglessness, so forth, then anger is not directed towards outside. Anger is automatically directed towards the self-centered attitude. Because without the self-centered attitude, without this mental development, the self-centered attitude, then you are the manifestation of the bliss and emptiness. With this bliss, which you can never get from external sources, the greatest of the bliss, very calm and peaceful bliss and happiness, this we never get from external sources. And this is it. And at the same time, that the bliss does not track you, that the bliss does not serve as a bait. For us, you have the wisdom of emptiness. So this makes you to even see this bliss as a dream life, so that you are not trapped by this bliss. And yet, because of this bliss, you don't feel tired. It is like a small children, so excitingly anticipating for the Christmas, and wishing that Christmas never ends. So this is what makes you to have so much of energy, endless energy, and never ever feeling exhausted and tired because of this. And this emptiness will make you not trapped in this bliss. So combined together, with this emptiness you will not trapped in samsara. This bliss will make you to reach out to all such things tirelessly. So this we have. And what forbids us from displaying this is the self-centered attitude. So the more we think in this line, and particularly keep in mind this line, next line, next line is so exhausting to think about how we just, this pain, this misery, just a boring life, and so much miseries, simply plays repeatedly, incessantly, with continuous. Then we think about this,
union of the bliss and emptiness, which is actually there within myself and not manifesting, then you become so angry to what forbids me from displaying these two qualities. So that is a self-centered attitude. Okay, this is one way of seeing the viciousness and the demands of cherishing oneself. Now the second part is, now at this point, while the Buddha nature is being obscured, okay, now we are already very vulnerable. We are already vulnerable. Vulnerable meaning we have to do what happens. We have to run away from suffering. So this is what we should be doing. Now, we are already being made vulnerable by the self-centered energy. Now, having become so vulnerable, and then we become so weak, that we always confront the miseries. We have run away from miseries. We are so poor that we don't have happiness. We crave for happiness. We are poor. We are suffering from the poverty of happiness. We are suffering from the weakness of having to run away from the miseries. So weak. So we are made like this because of self-centered attitude. Now, what does self-centered attitude do at this point? What it does is that it pushes away all happinesses, all factors which give you happiness. It pushes away. Because when you're very self-centered, nobody will come to you. When one is very self-centered, nobody will come to you. Right? Or the people who have potential to help you, they will all run away. And there are many more factors, many more of the cases also. And then it attracts all miseries. For example, say poverty. We don't know poverty. And say only when we have not experienced any form of these, either yourself or having seen that in your own life, then this you will not feel the weight of the poverty, or the misery of the pain of the poverty. So when you actually go to sometimes we visit places where people are stricken with poverty, where the whole family, they have to go to bed empty stomach. Whole family. And sometimes maybe they drink some water and they go to bed. So this is the reality. And the poverty is acute. Poverty is acute. In fact, say, and these are realities. At the time of Buddha, there was one, I don't know his the Sanskrit name in Tibetan. The Sanskrit name translated into Tibetan. His name is Kintamani. In English, it would be the one who gives food to the destitute. This is his name, and he was the one of the supporters of the Buddha, materially supporters of the Buddha. And what happened was that he was exceptionally rich. This man was exceptionally rich. In what way he was rich was that he has this eyesight, he has a special eyesight. He would just look at the ground like this, where the treasure is, he would identify. This is his. So treasures are there. For example, say, many places they remain unexcavated. The moment you excavate them, there are so many ruins there, so many treasures in there, right? And then natural treasures also there. Gold ores, silver ores, diamond, all this are there. So his eye, he has this special eyes to see the treasures under the ground. So naturally, he's going to be very rich. At the same time, he's a great devotee of the Bodhicitta and very compassionate. And not only that, he's rich and the supporter of the Bodhicitta, he is a Bodhisattva. So he connects as many people to the Bodhicitta as possible. So one time, when the Bodhicitta was invited by the king for lunch along with the monks, then this devotee, labor devotee, Kintamani, he stood up. In the middle of the lunch, he stood up. And then he, along with his
as a helpless assistant, they left. Where did he go? He went to the very remote places, the, what do you call that? Slum areas. He went to these places where all the poor people just look at the very dirty water flowing by, mosquitoes, and so prone to illness, and then nothing to eat, everywhere is dirty, everyone's fighting, like this. Then he and his, say, 5-6 attendants, he just asked them to bring huge sacks, bags. For what? Then went to all the slum area, and then he asked his attendants to shout to the people in slum area, saying that we have to know that the savior of the world has taken birth on this earth. The great enlightened being, the Bodhicitta, had taken birth on this earth. Now it is a great opportunity for all of us to take this as an opportunity to accumulate merit. So whatever little thing that you have, you give to us, and then I will take that to the Bodhicitta on your behalf. If you have, never mind. You don't have to give gold, silver, diamond, nothing. Whatever little that you have, say if you have some, say, wood as a fuel for cooking food, fuel wood, even the small piece you can give, right? And then if you have some sugar, give some sugar. If you have, whatever you have, whatever little thing that you have, you give, and we will take them to the Buddha so that you get the opportunity to accumulate merit. With this merit, in the future lives, you don't have to suffer the poverty that you're going through now. So this was his agenda. Then he was shouting and collecting the pieces. Everybody was so happy there in the slum area. That's very true. We heard about the enlightened way here, and we don't get the opportunity to go there. We are so busy looking for our getting just a meal. We hardly get a meal. And the king is very protective of this enlightened being. He would not allow all the beggars, many beggars, to go around the enlightened being. The king would be very protective. We used to operate with the king. So now it's a great opportunity for us. Everybody, all the poor people, they come with some small sticks, some needles, some threads, and then some, say, sugar, some, what is that? The brown sugar, then
molasses.
What is molasses? I heard what it was so many times. Okay, brown sugar, molasses. So they just bring everything, small things, and for this Kintamani messaging, this all garbage, because he's so rich, and for him, this all just garbage. But out of love to all these people, he was just picking up, collecting all of them. And just reassure them that I'll make sure that this will go to Buddha, and Buddha will have attention to you. So everyone was so happy. And then he was going, suddenly a very smelly piece of cloth from somewhere just fell right in front of Kintamani decision. And he felt a little offended. What is this? I'm doing this for the good of the poor people, and they are unhappy. Look, somebody tried to make me offended by throwing this very smelly, dirty cloth. It's a very bunch of smelly cloth. He became a little sad and offended. And then he gave a second thought. Oh, no, there must be a reason. Then he asked his attendants, tell me where this came from where? And there was one small hut. Very small hut. It came from this window. Then he asked his attendants to go check who's there. Perhaps someone to deliberately to provoke them, or they could be another reason. Then they went in. They saw that there were two very old couples
very old, aged like 80, 90, very old, almost naked, both naked, nothing in the hut, nothing, literally nothing, and even the roof, just licking, just nothing, and very dark, and both of them very skinny, so old. The moment these people, they enter, two of them start shivering, and then they said, what happened? And then two of them narrated the story that, okay, we have nothing to do. And we know that we are the poorest in this universe. We are the poorest in this universe. We have nothing to do. And we know that the enlightened being has appeared on this earth. And we know that it's a great opportunity for us to accumulate merit by making offerings to the enlightened one. And yet we know that we don't have anything to offer. Now that you come, we heard your voice. We heard your voice. And then we come to know that this voice is so pleasant, so compassionate. And it's just for us. And yet I have nothing to give. Even if you come next to my door, just on my door, I have nothing to give. So what they have is just this piece of cloth. This piece of cloth, when the man goes out to beg for food, old man, he would wrap around his body, then he would go to bed. And the old lady would be in the naked in the house. When the old lady goes out to beg for food, old lady would wear it, and then the old man would naked in the house. So this piece of cloth is the source of survival for two of us. So now we come to know that this is a great, great, great opportunity for us. And yet we have nothing to offer. Now, only thing, if somebody can offer, this is the only thing. So if we offer this, both of us are going to die. Because we can't go out naked for begging. So we're going to die. Then we decide that better we die than not make the offering. Because if we don't make the offering, we are losing such a great opportunity to accumulate merit. Without making this merit with this such opportunity, then we will again take birth with this poverty in the future lifetimes. So we just decided to give a life. Give a life. At least that in the future lifetimes we don't suffer the same poverty. So this is what makes us to give this. And at the same time, we cannot come out naked to give this. So we threw this. We are very sorry. So this is what they said. And they were so moved, they immediately went down to meet the Kintamani session and narrate the story. And he felt so touched. He went in and Kintamani session, he looked even more elegant. So elegant that the two of them, old lady and the man woman, both of them seeing him, simply they became even more frightened. Even more frightened. And he reassured that don't worry, we are here to take care of you. And more than us, your cloth will go to the enlightened one directly. Right? So I will bring this to you, his attention. So don't worry. So he reassured them that not worry. And they were so relieved. Then what happened? Then they were collecting all the things. And then they went to where the Buddha was, in front of the king, then Buddha and all the monks. Then what they did, they put all the garbage next to Buddha. There was this garbage, and it's very smelly garbage. And then on the other hand, the king, after the serving food, in the end, the king would offer, so whatever he has offered, the clothes, then the gold, diamond, whatever, to the Buddha. The king has all these things very dear. Then, after the meal, the king offered all these things to Buddha. Then, after making the offering, it was the custom that the Buddha dedicates the merit by citing the name of the owner, citing the name of the sponsor of the meal. So, what the Buddha did, and then Kintamani and his friends, the assistants, He did not say anything to the Buddha. Because the Buddha is enlightenment. So you don't say anything. You don't report about these people. So why they said that we will bring this to the Buddha? In any ways, Buddha will come too late. We will give attention to these things, even without being said. And they said it so that the people will feel relieved and happy. And the Buddha, when it was time for him to say the dedication, and give the discourse by signing the name of the main sponsor, then Buddha, what Buddha did was that his hands, as described yesterday, contraction, everything so perfect. And the king felt so offended, looking at this garbage is in his palace now, in front of Buddha. It was so smelly, and he just felt like covering his nose, but the Buddha was not covering the nose. So he could not cover the nose. Then what the Buddha did, Buddha just put his hand, very beautiful hand, into this garbage and pulled the cloth, and put it in his hand as though like it is like his own child, put it in his hand. And then he started saying the dedication. He said the prayer, that by the merit of giving this food and all the offerings here by the donors, particularly, then the Buddha cited the two names of the old man and the old man. Particularly the two and all other donors. The king become all others, not the main. So the main is two of them. And that they live long and their wishes be fulfilled according to the Dharma. Right? And they be able to become Buddha, they be able to benefit all sentient beings. And the king felt even more offended that Venerable Enlightened One, am I not the main sponsor for this? And the Buddha said, for me, what amount of wealth offered, it does not count. The heart comes. And of all these people, including you, who made the offering to me and the monks, of all these people, this couple, the old lady and the old man, the heart that they have towards me is far excelling. Nobody can compare. So these two are the main sponsors today. And then he asked, who are these two? And Buddha immediately said that these two, they give this cloth to me, sacrificing their lives. They know that they're going to die by giving this cloth to me. They have no source of income. They cannot go out naked to beg for the food. And yet, they are ready to die to give this cloth to me. This is the heart they have, the kind of amount of the trust, the devotion, and the heart, ready to give their life to make some offering to me. So this is the most important thing today. It's so smelly, and the Buddha is taking care as well, like it is like his own child. And then the king, he was so moved. So these two people, these two, the couple, the Buddha loves them so much. The Buddha loves them so much. And then they're so poor. How can I give someone to whom the Buddha loves, and yet they're suffering so much? I cannot let it be like this, because I have so much reverence to the Buddha, I must make the Buddha happy. So Buddha will be happy only if those who he loves, they are happy. So I should make them happy. Instantly, he ordered his ministers to look for the two couple, to give them house, to give them wealth, to give them food, clothing, everything. So the ministers, they were so busy looking for the two couples. And then they entered in this slum area. And then coming to this area, all these ministers with the very elegant attires entered into the house, and then the two couples, they start shivering even more. Now the king must have sent ministers to kill us for offending the Buddha. And the ministers, they are even more respectful to two of them. It was so respectful because the king warned them that you must treat them with great, great respect. And they were given such a respect, they were so puzzled. What is this? The king must have sent them to kill us, but they are so respectful. So instantly, very instantly, they got house, two of them got good house, and then clothes, food, wealth, everything. Instantly, they became well off. Right? So this is what I'm saying. Say the poverty. And the poverty is the result of our lack of generosity. And the moment the generosity is engaged in, then the poverty is dispelled. And we depend on wealth. Because we are, in fact, the Buddha nature, if that becomes vibrant, we don't need wealth. Wealth for what? Wealth for what? Wealth so that I have good food. Good for what? So that my body is going to be healthy. When this Buddha nature awakened, your body is always healthy. And then water, heat, they cannot affect you, so you don't need a house. And you don't need a car, you can fly. Yeah, all the wealth, we have a false illusion that wealth is something. Actually, this wealth is for you. Because our body is so limited, our body cannot travel to a place, say like from here to Singapore, within like how many hours per flight? 2.5 hours. So our body cannot move within 2.5 hours. So we depend on external flight. Whereas our body cannot survive on its own. So we depend on food. And more of our body, we need house, AC, aircon, all these things. For what? Because our body cannot bear the heat, but our body cannot bear the cold. So this body is so weak. So because we need house, AC, and the heater, all these things we need because this body is so weak. Whereas if you have this Buddha nature fully awakened, the body is so perfect. No external conditions can affect the body. So what need of all these things? In fact, this is all burden. And we don't see them as burden because our body is so weak and we need them. Right? So therefore, the thing is that while the Buddha nature is being obscured by this vicious self-centered attitude, then it made us vulnerable. The body is made so limited and so weak. And because of which, we have to depend on external wealth. And for external wealth, it is a dependent origination. External wealth comes by dependence on your generosity, on the practice of generosity. So, at the same time, for us, what forbids us from practicing generosity? Our miserliness, stinginess. And what makes us stingy? Our self-centered attitude. Again, look, this self-centered attitude is pushing away the wealth. First of all, it made me heavily depend on the wealth. Now it's pushing away the wealth. Right? Pushing away the wealth by not allowing you to engage in generosity. Right? Without generosity, wealth is not. Will not come to you. Because some people, some children, they're born into a very wealthy family, and some people, some children, they're born in such a poor, poor family. For example, say in some places, say in Delhi, under 47 degrees centigrade, some of the mother beggars, they take the child under this 47 degrees centigrade, this young child, maybe a few months old, exposed to this heat because of poverty, right? So, first of all, we are made heavily dependent on the material resources by the self-centered attitude. We lost our freedom. Now that we become so dependent, now the self-centered attitude, it pushes away what makes you happy, the material resources, by not allowing you to engage the causes of the wealth. And causes of wealth is generosity. It stops you from practicing generosity. Generosity says that I will help others. Self-centered attitude says that no, you should be self-sufficient. Don't give to others. So you are just putting in poverty. And then say we don't like to take birth as animals, or we don't like to take birth as hell beings, honey ghost beings, lower beings. And we don't want to be born as so
what the vulnerable and say abnormal, right? And to say we don't want to be born as autistic and with these limitations. And then this self-centered attitude, it makes us to born like this. Because these favorables, these are the result of your practice of morality, of particularly refraining from harming others. Morality of refraining from harming others. So the moment somebody talks badly to you, immediately you fire at the other person, you start shouting at the other person. So you harm others. Because of this harm, then the immorality of harming others, that causes you to take birth in low realms. Right? So all these things, and what make you to fight back? Who's telling you to fight back? Self-centered attitude asks you to fight back. Corruption, fight, all these things. How? Self-centered attitude comes in the facade of your bodyguard. It comes in the facade of your, protection. And saying that, how stupid you are, you're not fighting with this person is so harmful to you. And then it gives you false courage to fight with the person. Right? And you fight, or you engage in the immorality of engaging in the harm others. So that makes you to take birth in the lower realms. Look how vicious. And then say, the practice of patience. Practice of patience is the one which allows you to have the radiance awareness. Say the appearance of radiance in you. For example, my teacher, Venerable Gyanamitra, his book Calming the Mind is extremely helpful. Venerable, my teacher, when he's coming out in the public, everybody could see a radiance in him. Everybody could see him glowing, such a radiance. Everybody would ask, who is this? Right? Who is this? So there's a radiance here. Okay, everybody is simply attracted. So this radiance is given rise to by the practice of patience. And the practice of patience, without the practice of patience, the radiance, you will not have the radiance. And everybody likes to have this special radiance. And who forbids you from practicing patience? Self-centered attitude. Self-centered attitude says that if somebody strikes you, strike back. Don't be patient. If you're patient, you're stupid. Who is saying this? Self-centered attitude says this. Because of this lack of patience, lack of forbearance, lack of tolerance, lack of fortitude, right? Then, in next birth, you're born without any glow, without any radiance. This is because of the, again, the self-centered attitude. And then the enthusiasm or joyous effort. Joyous effort would give you, would practicing joyous effort would give you the next lives, the next lives will give you elegance. And this elegance, everybody likes to, you know, appear oneself as so elegant. And this is in fact what really surprises me, right? For example, say, if Hollywood star or Bollywood star comes to the city, everybody will look after them, right? You don't need any teaching with Bodhicitta, right? Everybody will come. And you charge them, you charge $1,000, people will come, people will pay, ready to pay. They don't, what do they get? They get zero, nothing, right? They just ready to pay, thousands of dollars, ready to pay, right? And they would sing a song, they would just perform some dance, and then they leave, they collect the money, they leave, right? And what do you get? Nothing, zero, right? And yet people are crazy. So why are they so popular? Why are they so popular? Tell me. Not because that they have the compassion of the His Holiness the Dalai Lama, no. Not because the integrity which Mahatma Gandhi has, no. For example, integrity. One thing I'm so amazed is the integrity. I read the biography of Prophet Muhammad. His integrity is amazing. His integrity. I was just baffled
to see the integrity of Prophet Muhammad and the love of Jesus Christ. These stars, Bollywood stars, people were attracted not because that they have the love of Jesus Christ, no. Not because that they have this incredible compassion like the Dalai Lama, no. Not because of the integrity which Prophet Muhammad Mahmoud they have, no. But simply because of what? Physical appearance. Yes, no. Simply because of physical appearance. Right? Physical appearance. And what is so special there? Just look at very seriously. What is so special? No, two eyes, one nose, two ears. In what way they are so special? In what way? So special. Right? One, there is something which attracts the people. There's a glow in the air. There's an elegance in the air. And this is purely the result of their previous karma of engaging in the practice of patience and the practice of enthusiasm, joy, sadness, right? Just that. And yet, because it is coming, the next life, whether they will have the same, not guaranteed. But with compassion, integrity, bodhicitta, wisdom and emptiness, then next life guaranteed. What you have today, you'll carry next life. But the elegance and the radiance that we have in this life, we are not sure whether we will have the same thing next life. So in any ways, with these things, we like people to give attention to you, and these attract the attention. And yet, self-centered attitude, it pushes away this, because it does not allow you to practice and to just effort, and instead it allows you to be lazy, self-centered. We tend to be lazy, yes, no. Right? With the practice of Bodhicitta, okay, now we want, oh, we are so fortunate, we give call to each other. Oh, 1 week I went to Bali, what did you do? Bodhicitta, how's that? Amazing, amazing. So it's amazing last for the next 2-3 days. Right? Amazing, amazing. If it's really amazing, then consistency should be there. Right? In 2-3 days it disappears. Right? Okay, then the next day, oh, it's Bodhicitta, the moon. The Vajra, wow, it's amazing. Then next day, amazing is less. Vajra, the sound is even less. Then the third day, Vajra, the fourth day, okay, I forgot what to do. Oh, okay, I forgot to go for shopping. Oh no, there's a deadline there, right? And then number four, I'll do tomorrow. But no, it doesn't matter. The next week, weekend. Weekend, I'll do it for 2-3 hours. Right? And the weekend comes, oh, I feel a little tired. Right? And the first weekend we may do it for 30 minutes. And the second weekend we forgot that. Right? Okay. So what I'm saying is that these are all the signs of laziness. And who made us to be lazy? No one. It's just a self-centered attitude. Right? This self-centered attitude tells us be lazy. Right? Be happy. Why should you do Bodhicitta practice? It's so boring practice. It's so mechanical. If you don't believe, continue doing this for 1 month and you see that it becomes mechanical. And you do it continuously in 1 month, you will see that it's mechanical. Oh, is that true? Then you leave it. Right? So the who is telling you to be lazy? Self-centered attitude. And on top of the self-centered attitude tells you one thing. Then don't do this practice. Effect is not there. Result is not there. Right? There's no result. Right? You will never become one like Dalai Lama. If you don't believe, do it. And you see they, after 3 days. Then one day, day two, they say, oh, that's very true. There's no result. Everybody, just as I go out, usually where there's a difficulty with someone, it's the same thing. So there's no result, there's no effect. Right? So if the result is not seen, okay, anyways, it doesn't matter. I'll do next week. Then it disappeared. So what made you to be lazy? It's a self-centered attitude. It is just trying to convince us. There's no result, so what should we do? What's the point in doing? Instead of that, go to beach. Instead of that, go to pub. Drink and you find fun. It's so visible there. You can see the effect there. You will have socialize with people. In the pubs, not socializing in group Bodhicitta retreat, socializing in the pubs. There's so much fun there. Self-grasping ignorance, self-centered attitude tells all these things. Right? Okay, so therefore, we see that all the good things which can potentially come to us, these are all pushed away by the self-centered attitude. Right? Now, if you very seriously think about how vicious this self-centered attitude is, first reflect on how this self-centered attitude comes to you. Comes to you in the facade of your best friend, one. Comes to you in the facade of the best of the protector and the best of the benefactor. Now, we come to know that slowly, after the step number six, you know, step number seven, we'll come to know that this self-centered attitude, it is so devious and so deceptive, right? It simply deceives us, comes in the pretext of helping you, and it is bringing all the harm. And when you really need someone, say this, a mug of tea, this self-centered attitude does not have the capacity to bring it. Even this mug of tea is brought on the table through the hands of so many other people, self-centered attitude cannot bring it. It is only by dependence. This mug is made of people, and the tea inside is made by Bhavana, right? And this mug also, the plastic came from the petrol, and the steel, they came from the iron ore, whatever. And how many people are involved in the mines, and how many people died there, how many people brought them to the factory, and how many people were there in the very hot fire furnace, getting all this melting, the purifying of the ores and so forth. With all these hands that this come, self-centered attitude, it cannot bring even a glass of water to you. Self-centered attitude, it comes as though like it's the best of your protector, it's the best of your friend, it's total deception. It cannot give you anything good. It simply attracts all miseries. Behind scene, it brings all miseries. In front, it gives you the impression as though like it is your best friend and the best protector. This is how elusive, how deceptive, how vicious this self-centered attitude is. Okay, so this is point number two. Now what's point number three? Anyone? Point number three? Reflecting on the merits of cherishing others. Okay. Reflect on the merits of cherishing others. So now, these things we have to constantly think. And then you may think that, so it's very natural to be self-centered. It's very natural. Through this practice, over and over again, you'll see that other thing becomes very natural to you. Other cherishing becomes natural to you. And self-centered attitude, you will so envy to accept it, right? Okay. So reflecting on the benefit of cherishing others. So the more you cherish others, I gave you two things. What you did for the self-centered attitude, do the reverse, opposite to the other cherishing one. So the more you cherish others, self-centered attitude slowly is peeled off, is removed. As the self-centered attitude removes, what happened? The Buddha nature slowly comes out. Right? Buddha nature slowly comes out. When the Buddha nature comes out fully, you don't have to depend on any external things. You're forever happy. The union of bliss and emptiness comes to you. You're forever, 24/7, you have the maximum happiness, far more than the richest and the most powerful person. You are the happiest person, right? So who made it? By removing the stain of the self-centered attitude, by the practice of the Adisharsha mind. If you don't believe, just experiment it. Just experiment it for like 1 month, experiment it. Right? Start cherishing others. Start cherishing others. So for example, at home you are with your mother, you just make a promise. Even if my mother says something nasty, whatever, I will be always nice to her. Right? I will just, my agenda will be changed from what is correct to what makes her happy. I will change the agenda. Right? Okay, so for example, say, your mother wants to say, what is the answer here? Okay, let's say, your mother wants to say chat with other people, right? Feeling so lonely by herself, wants to chat with neighbors and so forth. Okay, then your mother might have say bronchitis, say the problem with the lungs, whatever, talks, then the problem may aggravate. And then, say, the mother starts talking to the friends, talking to the neighbors, the friends. Hey mother, don't talk, you have this problem. You should be, you become sick, right? When does she really become sick? Yes, when she's by herself, thinking, constantly thinking, I'm so lonely, this makes her sick, right? This makes her sick. And then for you, what is correct and what makes her happy, you cannot distinguish the two. You want the correctness as more important than what makes her happy. Why should she be correct? Why should she be correct? If you ask this question, the answer will come to you, then she'll be happy. She just will become happy. If she's so correct, not talking to anyone, it doesn't make her happy. Right? It doesn't matter. Because of this stress and depression, it can create other complications. Whereas happiness can boost the immune system, and this immune system can stop many of the illnesses. Right? So therefore what I'm saying is that just experiment it for 1 month. I'll just make my mother happy. Of course, right? But the mother is diabetic and she says, I like to have Coca-Cola, I like to have chocolate, I like to have sweet, all these things. And then, yes, I'll make you happy for 1 month, right? This is too much. Always the middle way, right? Make sure that it's not excess. Even if your mother knows that the moment there's excess, she will have little guilt that I'm not going with the excess. And if you say, don't, you know, go to that extent, mother listen to you. But if you make it zero, don't do it. You have this diabetic, you are diabetic. No chocolate, diabetic, no sweet. Diabetic, right? You just eat, give only the bland food all the time, right? She becomes sick, right? Okay, so just for 1 month, experiment it. And then talk always nicely, gently. Even if she talks something, say, roughly like that, out of little agitation, right? From your side, just make it a joke, light joke. Make it a light joke and try to fulfill what she wishes. Within one week and 1 month, you will see the change. Your mother, she will start glowing. And your whole family members will see the change in you. And you're much happier. So we see that Adisharsha mind, there's just this very prominent effect being felt in you. Just experiment. Okay, so Adisharsha mind, it simply removes the self-centered attitude. Then Buddha nature within it becomes more and more prominent, right? And then we have to plan two things. One is the immediate happiness, and the other is long-term happiness. Think of two. Immediate happiness and the long-term happiness both. Long-term happiness too, right? When I grow older and my next life. Planning for when I grow older and the next life is much more the same. Because, say, okay, with this warm-heartedness, my immune system will be boosted. I will be more calm. When I'm more calm, agitation is not here. Agitation is the one which eats up my immune system. Agitation is not there. So immune system is restored. With this immune system restored, then
when a guru little older, like 60, 70, then 80, because of his immune system, I will live with better health, with more sound mind. Right? This is what happened. So for this, we practice Bodhicitta, Arishasha mind, subduing the self-centered attitude. So this, what you are thinking for your, say, all this time, this you will no doubt take to your next life. Next life you will become a very calm girl, one is a very calm girl, calm boy, and very sensible, even as a very young boy or young girl, someone who is very mature, looks at the child to see that this child is very special. Right? Not an agitated child, very special child. And everybody, and this child eventually, when we grow older, will take responsibility of the family, will take responsibility of the community, will take responsibility of the nation. Right? So long-term thing. And then of course, finding awakenings with the nature. Then one will become like Prince Siddhartha. Just one young prince, he became the light of the whole world. Right? So this is what you will become. Okay, this is reflecting on the merits of cherishing others. And then the merits of cherishing others, see, if you are really successful in these two steps, step number two, three, it is such a fun, such a joy, right? So in the process, simple stuff, generosity, with generosity, you see what, the future, I'm safe from poverty because of this generosity. And who's giving me this opportunity? This beggar, right? So without this beggar there, even if I want to engage in generosity, that the next life I don't suffer from poverty, I can't engage in it. Because the beggar is there, he's so kind that he's there for me to, allowing me to practice generosity. Right? And you may not find it so sensible. You will see the truth of this when you are in different situations. In fact, in Delhi, I feel really very unhappy not because of Delhi's bad, no? Because say if I have the food and my friends, my relatives, they come, you know, they give me some Tibetan staple food, sambar, right? Like this so good sambar, I cannot eat them, all these sambar, there's sambar I've meant for like 15, 20 days, I cannot eat them in one day, and so many people come to give them to me. And then I travel a lot, and coming home, all these things were waste. Where waste? I'm to town. In the garbage. Where is? And then other things, forget. The onion, what do you call it? Peels. Onion peels, then the mango skin, banana skin, these things, all in the garbage. Whereas I was once in a retreat, in a place, very solitude place. There's a grassland, and there were cows around. Wow, even one piece of onion peel, the moment it fell, I felt, no, I should pick it up. It's so precious for me, because this will go to my friends. Cow friends are there. It will all go for them. Wow, every small thing, nothing go waste. So, set of papers and the same. Whatever is not edible, I put them separately. What is edible, I put them separately. And then I give them to the cows. Look at the joy the cows they feel. Right? Nothing go waste. And then I become even more enthusiastic. Right? Seeing that nothing go waste, if the cows are enjoying it. Then, say, the cabbage. Pick one's cabbage, I put a couple of pieces, I add salt to them, mix them with the other things, mix them all together, and then the cows, they don't get everything, they get just a piece of, small piece, every cow. They love it. So therefore, I feel such joy, the cows are giving such joy to me,
right? And this opportunity I don't have in Delhi, right? What I get in Delhi, if it is the same thing I get in that place, the counselor, my counselor is so happy, right? And I'll be so happy. Every time I have to dump these things here, it makes me so sad. What a waste of resources. And I want to, you know, I want to engage in this practice of generosity to make the cows happy, to make everyone happy. But there's no one. Right? After everything goes there in the garbage. It makes me so sick and unhappy. So what I'm saying is that even for you to practice generosity, there must be someone there to receive it. Without that person, you can't do anything. So that without generosity, the poverty is bound to happen. And if you don't want to be trapped in poverty, generosity is inevitable. For the generosity, we need the kindness of someone to receive your generosity. So others are so kind to you in that respect. The more you value others who are there to receive your generosity. So this act of generosity, I'm not doing this for you, I'm doing this for me, right? And then if you think more deeply, I'm doing this, thank you for being here. You are helping me to kill my self-centered attitude. Thank you. It's such a fun, right? And then say somebody talks so nicely to you. Thank you for being here to talk so nicely on me. This gives me the opportunity to kill my self-centered attitude, to crush my self-centered attitude. Look, thank you. Because without someone talking nasty on you, how can you practice patience? Without the practice of patience, how can you subdue this self-centered attitude? Without subduing this self-centered attitude, how can you make your bodhicitta, Buddha nature come out? So for all these life reasons, it becomes so alive in you. The fact that you're able to do something good to others, right? I'm not doing good to you. You are helping me, right? You're helping me. You're so kind. You will never feel tired. You will never feel tired, and you will never feel, oh, I have done a favor for you. This attitude will never come to you. You are doing a favor for me. Amazing. Thank you. Right? So the act of helping others, act of cherishing others, become a fun for you. It's a great fun. Wow. What a journey to crush myself and an attitude. It's amazing. Amazing. Right? So if you really follow like this trend of thinking, your life is so beautiful. Your life is so beautiful. And then others are there, right? It's not that you are helping others, you are not for them. They are there for you. You will feel it. When you see that others are there for you, how come that you feel tired? Exhaustion, tiredness is never there. It's such a fun and joy, right? Every time you have to do something for them, your energy increases. Your energy to do something for others increases. Your compassion increases. And your leadership quality increases. Right? Your leadership quality increases. For example, say, in this group, let's say, Venda, he's doing all these things just purely out of benefiting others. This is just the motivation. So in the process, his leadership qualities, his compassion, automatically grows, day by day it grows. Right? So therefore, we see that the good things that we do for others, if we know the steps, step one, two, three, these three steps, so well in your mind, so well convinced in your mind, what you do, you're not doing for others. Others are doing for you. Right? And particularly for what? For crushing your self-centered attitude. Crush your self-centered attitude and everybody will come to you. Look at His Holiness Dalai Lama. Right? And people want to make appointment, you have to make appointment, say 1 year ahead. You want to see him, you have to make appointment 1 year ahead. For us, you can meet anytime. But please come, nobody will come. Please come to meet me. Nobody will come. Right? And for His Holiness, there are thousands and thousands and thousands in wait list. Right? So His compassion attracts people. Right? And on top of that, one, immediately, everybody will come with smile and happiness. because of the
Avishesha.
And then in the process, what happens? The most interesting part is that finally, without saying no to the self-centered attitude, this Buddha nature will never come out. So we have to say no to the self-centered attitude. And who says no to self-centered attitude most effectively is Adishyakshi mind. And Adishyakshi mind, others we hear. Without others, we cannot have the Adishyakshi mind. So others are so kind that you are allowed, you are given the opportunity to practice Adishyakshi mind. With this Adishyakshi mind, every process, for example, say if someone is a gold collector, every piece of the gold, be it a tiny gold, he will not let it go like this. He'll pick it up because it's so precious. Likewise, other cherishing, this every bit is more precious than the gold because every bit distorts the self-centered attitude. If the gold cannot do that work, gold and diamond cannot do to remove the self-centered attitude. Whereas every piece of cherishing others, helping others, making others happy, working for others, you're not only working for others. Others are there for you to engage in this challenging work of challenging this self-centered attitude. In the process, your Buddha nature becomes awakened. It becomes awakened every time, right? And slowly, your Buddha nature comes out. Your Buddha nature comes out fully. You don't have to depend on material resources. You don't have to depend on any other external things. You are forever, 24/7, unity of the bliss and emptiness within you. You don't have to depend on anything else. No temperature can affect you. No hunger can affect you. Right? No, say, distance can affect you. Distance, let me say, the hunger, and this makes no sense. Right? What, say, the person, the richest people, they may go for holidays on Concorde's already shut down. Right? Why shut down is so expensive? Even if you're the richest person, you have your private jet, but at least it will take a few hours. And with this Buddha nature coming out, it does not take even a second, you can go there. And then the richest person may have Antarctic Circle, they may put the strongest of the heating system, right? Most of the heating system, but you have to be in the house. You cannot get out. But in your case, with this Buddha nature coming out fully, manifesting fully, your body can adapt to any temperature without difficulty, right? So whether you go out or go in, heating is there. Whereas sometimes one of my cousin sisters called me, it was very hot. And she said, oh, that is so hot, it's difficult for you. I said, no, it's not a problem. Oh, but Geshe, I didn't have AC. And I said, but there's no AC on the road. I told you that, right? Okay, so what I'm saying is that even if you're the richest, but you can't put AC on the road. Yeah, that's very true. You cannot. But with your body, with your Buddha nature manifesting fully, right? External temperature is like 22 degrees centigrade, with outside, inside. No temperature can affect you, right? And hunger, no situation can put you in hunger, right? You don't depend on food. Forever, 24/7, you are with bliss, unity of the bliss and emptiness. This is the benefit of awakening this beautiful Buddha nature. Okay, so this is point number two. Now point number four and five. Point four, five will go together. So point number four, five is known as practice of tonglen, giving and taking, giving your happiness and taking the miseries of others. If you remember this morning when we do the soft offering, we read somewhere about this practice of tonglen. Okay, page 254. Page 254. The last stanza, stanza 99. Okay, stanza 98. Page 254. 254, stanza 98. Inspired me to immediately conjoin with meditation, whatever I encounter, by the skillful means of having the four applications, and to make this opportunity worth worthwhile, by practicing the advice of the commitments of mind training, so that I may rescue all beings from the vast ocean of becoming. Inspire me to master true bodhicitta through love, compassion, and the superior intention. Conjoined with the technique of mounting, taking, and giving upon the breath. So this is the practice. To conjoin with the technique of mounting, taking, and giving upon the breath. Okay. Conjoin with the technique of mounting, this practice, taking, and giving. Mounting with this practice upon the breath. Okay. This is point number, practice number 4 and 5. This one is the practice of Tonglen. Tibetan is known as Tonglen. Taking and giving. Taking is Len and giving is Tong. Tonglen. Tonglen practice. So, with the say, with step number 1, 2, 3, with these three steps intact, with these three steps intact, then what happened? What happened is that any time you do something good for others, right? Good for others, you feel that others are doing good for you. Not that you're going to do good for others. You feel that others are going to do good for you. If people are, you are surrounded by people who are so sensitive, who are so sensitively kind towards you, right? And when you need the person's DNA, when you don't want the person, you know, they just push back, and then you don't have to worry about these people. They are always there to take care of you. Are you happy or not? You're very happy. You're very happy. Sometimes if people overdo, particularly mothers, they overdo to the children. The child is already 20, 40 years old. So the mother worries about the child. Did you eat something? Where did you go? Come on time. Right? Still the mother, you're already 40 years old. You're already, in some cases, 50 years old. Still the mother asks, please come on time. Right? Why are you late? This is overly possessive. Right? Okay. Otherwise, what I'm saying is that if you really feel that what I'm doing for others is not really, I'm doing for others. Others are doing for me, others are so kind, right? If you could feel that, you're forever energetic. You're forever energetic. With this practice, then the practice of Tonglen, giving happiness to others, is not actually giving happiness to others. Others are giving the opportunity for you to be happy. And then taking the business to others, oh no, you're not actually, you do this practice deliberately, taking the business to others on you. But for you, it is, for your own benefit, that taking business to others, it gives my self-satisfaction, right? And then it unravels the Buddha nature, the treasure within. Wow! So taking the suffering of others is not I'm being burdened. Giving my happiness, I'm losing my happiness. No! Giving my happiness multiplies. Taking the business of others, I'm not miserable. I don't become miserable. I become even happier. My source of misery is being killed, crushed, which is self-satisfaction, right? So therefore, with this practice of Tonglen, if you are very successful, only if you are very successful in step 1, 2, 3, then step 4, 5, it will never burn you out. Whereas if you do the practice 4 and 5 separately, without the first three, you can easily feel the burnout, you can feel the burdensome that you are taking the business of others, you will feel the burden. When you feel the burden, you don't feel the joy. If you don't feel the joy, you cannot go. So the journey is not a journey of joy. Without joy and journey, the journey will never come to an end. Only with the joy, the journey will come to an end with the destination. Okay, right? So therefore, the practice of Tonglen. Now, how you do the practice of Tonglen? There are so many ways of doing it. So what is that? They said this in this text, stanza 99. Stanza 99, which says, so that I may rescue all beings from the vast ocean of becoming, inspire me to master true bodhicitta through love, compassion, and superior intention, conjoined with the technique of mounting, taking, giving upon the breath. So this last two lines, according to these two lines, how do we do this practice? How do we do this? When we do this practice? Now, okay, sit upright. Okay, sit upright. We'll do this practice. Point number 45. Imagining that we are all very successful in step 1, 2, 3. Where you feel that anything good that you do for others, you are actually doing good for yourself, right? And anything you are taking the messages of others onto yourself, you are actually, the person is actually doing a great favor for you to eliminate your enemy of self-centered attitude. So with this conviction, then we will do step number 4 and 5. Okay, how we do this, step 4 and 5? Step 4 is taking the miseries of others onto yourself. Taking the miseries of others onto yourself. Okay, so miseries can be divided into 3. Evident suffering, then the suffering change, and the pervasive conditioned suffering. Right? Evident suffering, you can think about the people who are really going through such tragic pains, like in the hands of terrorists, like in the hands of, say, in the hospices, in the hospitals, with cancer, with AIDS, and then the animals in the hands of the butchers, in KFC, in the five-star hotels, and so forth. Just two of these, and all the manifest pains, as you breathe in, you breathe three times, as you breathe in, imagine that all these pains, if possible, initially you begin with one particular pain. Say, for example, the pain of the people who are going through the acute illness and in hospices. So the fear that they're going through, just imagine that you are taking these pains, sucking these pains through your left nostril. As you breathe in, you suck them in the form of very dirty, polluted torrents of water, very fossil water, very dirty, polluted, and the snakes, scorpion, the old inside here, which are all manifestation of the pains of them. You suck them all in through your left nostril. As you breathe in, you breathe in, you suck them in, and then as you start breathing out, imagine that all they just go to fight with this self-centered attitude and self-grasping, particularly self-centered attitude within your heart, which is resting so peacefully, just fighting with this, and self-centered attitude is killed. And imagine that they're really eating up something inside. You feel little the uneasiness here, little, a kind of fear coming. If that happens, this is when the effect is taking place. Okay, we'll do this and 3 times. Okay, next. So in your practice, every day you can shift from one suffering to another suffering to the third suffering and so forth. And then you can think about poverty. We just suck in all the poverty, the pain of the poverty, the pain of hunger and so forth. Likewise, the pain of the loss of life. So like this, you can do one by one, one by one. So for us here, now number 2, we will just take the suffering change. Suffering change, which is the vicious element, the bait, the nature of the bait nature, the viciousness of the samsaric pleasures. These samsaric pleasures, they trap us in samsara. And then let us continue to suffer endless sickness, aging, death. So what made us always be in samsara is because there's something there which lures us. That is the samsara pleasures. So samsara pleasures are really seen as the suffering change, which eventually changes to miseries. Okay, we'll take the viciousness of the samsaric pleasures of all the sentient beings And then we suck them in, because many people, they are just intoxicated by money. They're intoxicated by power. They're intoxicated by youth. Right? They can't really think of anything beyond that. They think that money is everything, power is everything, youth is everything. And they're just intoxicated by that. Right? They can't think of a greater meaning of their life. So what made them not to feel the greater meaning of their life is because of the intoxication that they're drowned in these samsaric pleasures. Right? So see through the viciousness of the samsaric pleasures. And many of these people, they're so bright. If they come to this, for example, Bodhicitta Retreat, they will be so amazed to see a very different world of thinking. They will simply drop everything of what they were doing. Corruption, all these things. They will see a very different world on it. Real peace, genuine happiness. But they don't come to this place because they're drowned, they're intoxicated by what they're going through, by what they're going through. Okay. So we just suck in the vicious, the element of the viciousness of the, say, the worldly, the pleasures, three times. And in the form of sin, in the form of very dirty torrents, very forceful torrents, with the snakes, very poisonous snakes, and the scorpions and so forth, just gushing in, and then eating something inside. What's that? Eating up the cells. When there's a little tickling sensation coming inside you, a fear coming to you, your self-centered attitude is affected. This is a very good indication. Okay, let's do it three times. Imagine that self-centered attitude is already eaten up, and you are so relieved that now the Buddha nature is becoming vibrant, and all the sentient beings, they are freed from the suffering, and suffering change. Okay, number three. Now taking the third level of suffering, pervasive conditioned suffering, which is that our being the slave of the self-centered attitude and the self-grasping ignorance. Our being the slave of the contaminated karmas and the afflictions, particularly self-grasping and self-centered attitude. How the beings, they are the slave of the self-centered attitude and self-grasping ignorance. For example, in dream, you dream of something very pleasurable feeling, pleasurable things, then you are so excited, and then in the dream, you see say the ghost chasing you, so much of fear. There's no ghost there. There's no say the enduring object here. It's just that you are the slave of this dream. This dream is what your mind creates. Now this dream is dictating on you, your emotions. This dream is dictating your emotions, which means you become the slave of the dream. Likewise, what we are all going through, they are just created by the self-grasping ignorance. Seeing things as so vibrant like this, and sometimes very pleasurable, sometimes so undesirable, just making you so panicky, fearful, frightened, and so forth. So all these things are created by the self-grasping ignorance and self-centered ignorance. So we are the slave of the self-grasping ignorance. And then say, what we are going to be tomorrow? We never know. Our karma decides. So we are the slave of the karma. Right? After 30 years, where you are going to be? Right? After 20 years, where you are going to be? I don't know. Who decides? Your karma decides. So we are the slave of the karma. Right? And then say, there could be a disaster coming to you, tragedy falling on you, so forth. Who decides? It's not in your hand. Is a karma. So your karma, you're the slave of the karma. And what makes this karma? Who created this karma? The afflictions. And you are the slave of the afflictions. And who creates these afflictions? Self-centered attitude. You are the slave of self-centered attitude. So we see that our being under the slave of the self-centered attitude and self-grasping ignorance, as long as we are under the slave of the contaminated karmas and the afflictions, there is never happiness. We are always the slave. Slave means you don't have the freedom. Loss of freedom is misery. This is samsara. Right? So what makes us loss of freedom? Because what we are is determined by the self-grasping, contaminated karmas and afflictions, particularly self-grasping ignorance. So we're the slave of that. Being a slave, what is worse than being a slave? For example, we have a boss who is so rude, so cold, right? So, as long as the boss does not leave the work permanently, right, you are never liberal, never peace of mind. Even though you go for a holiday, 10-day holiday, no, 7 days holiday in Bali for the Bodhicitta Retreat. Right? First day you're very happy, everybody's smiling. Then day two, day three, day four, as the is coming to an end, then again trauma comes back. Right? Why? Because still you are not freed from this vicious boss. And more vicious than human boss is the self-grasping, ignorance, self-centered attitude. These two are 24 hours with you. At least human balls can be separated for one week. But these two balls, they are 24 hours with you. They are so vicious. Right? Okay. And particularly if you get a glimpse of emptiness. If you get a glimpse of emptiness, then you see that the self-grasp of ignorance, it really bullies us. It really bullies us. Like a dream. In a dream, say what the Bodhicitta said in the dream, Samadhi Raja Sutra, just as in a dream of a young beautiful girl, she met with a boy and saw his death. Joyous was she at the meeting and despair over his death. View all phenomena as thus. So in the dream, a girl met with a young boy, very excited, so much excitement there, right? And then, if somebody says, are you enjoying, are you happy? Oh, I'm very happy. The next moment, the boy suddenly starts coughing, right? And the blood comes out, and the boy collapses, right? The whole world collapses, the whole world becomes so gloomy. No, the life is meaningless. It's so gloomy, the whole world collapses. Such a pain, such a fear, such anguish comes to you, right? Okay, you wake up. Oh, I was totally deceived. Who deceived? Who made you to have all this fluctuating emotion? The dream. And who created the dream? Yourself. But the dream is not detaining on you. You are not detaining the dream. You do not. You cannot manipulate the dream. The dream is manipulating you. Dream is the remote controller. The dream is the remote control. And sometimes it makes you very happy, excited. And sometimes it makes you very unhappy. The remote control is not in your hand. Which means, you are in the hand of the self. Who made this dream? The dream of the illusion. Self-grasping ignorance. So self-grasping ignorance is keeping the remote control of your emotions. So you are the slave of self-grasping ignorance. If you are the slave, you don't have the freedom. Loss of freedom is the worst of the misery. This is known as the samsara. Right? So now, with this third, when you take to the third set, you take the miseries the beings are going through because of having become the slave of the contaminated karmas and the afflictions, and particularly the self-grasping ignorance. You take them all and imagine they're all free, they all wake up from the sleep of ignorance, they now suffer, they don't suffer anymore now. Okay, this is what we're going to do three times. In the form of very black soup, very dirty, polluted torrents of water, and with the snakes inside, crocodiles inside, and the scorpions inside, they just go into your left nostril, and then they just eat up inside you. Actually, a tickling sensation, fear comes in. This is a sign of this success. Okay, we do three times. Okay. Now imagine that all these are freed of all the miseries, all three kinds of miseries. Now they're woken up from the sleep of ignorance. Now they are not going to be affected by any dreams, all dreams of these samsara stops, and they're experiencing the true awakening, enlightenment, and happiness and peace. And you, the Buddha, because the sunset attribute is already eaten up, the Buddha nature has become full awakened. Right? This is a win-win situation. You and the other sentient beings. Other sentient beings, they are already benefited by you, by taking the miseries from you. And in your case, the miseries that you've taken has already eaten up a self-centered attitude, and your Buddha nature has become fully awakened. So you become like a sun, where nobody can affect you, no darkness can obscure you. Right? Okay. So this is a practice of lend, taking the miseries of others on you. So, and then we can do the same practice in relation to, say, if you see that some people are sick, you know, friends, your near and dear ones, when they are sick, you can take this practice. You can do this practice by taking the miseries and suffering, the sickness, ill, and whatever of the other to you, towards you, through this terminal stroke. Okay. And I remember His Holiness that was saying that if you do this practice, particularly dedicated for those people who are going through very difficult times, taking their miseries, this is the best of the puja performance. Puja performance meaning ritual performance for the recovery. Okay, it's 10:57. Activity break. Okay, what time do we come back? It's like 11:20. Okay, we'll come back at 11:20.